You may have noticed some new changes at Masses this weekend with the introduction of some Latin, some incense. We're going to talk to Father Ross today about those changes and about the season of Advent to kind of educate us all on our liturgical season.
Yeah. All right. So what's your, do you have any, so when you look at like some of those, I don't know, traditions, is there anything like questions that come to your head about like what it's all about or anything?
I think one question that might come up would be why Latin? Why does the church use that? And why are we specifically using that more during Advent?
Gotcha. Well, remember, so I kind of talked about this a little bit at Mass in Boone previously, but for those that weren't there, for those that are just curious a little bit more about it, when we talk about Advent, we're talking about like the beginning of something new, because it's a like it's a new part of the church year. So we've kind of turned the calendar over into Advent for this year. And so you'll see a lot of these changes that we're kind of doing just to kind of like mark a little bit of a difference, because I think we get used to kind of doing the same thing more or less over and over. So this is a good way, like part of the lesson of the Advent season is to kind of remain alert or to kind of be ready. And so these ways in a real way kind of challenge us to even almost like pay more attention to like, oh, there's something new going on. So it kind of probably, if you were at some of those masses where we use some of these elements, it probably was kind of a little jarring, but that's kind of the point, is to kind of wake us up in that sense and to kind of engage us and to help us to think about kind of what we're doing a little bit more. So you were asking about the chant. And obviously you and me growing up, we both grew up in the Omaha Metro, but even more than that, it's like, did you really experience a lot of chant growing up so much?
No, I mean, okay. I remember a little bit maybe during Lent at our church, but when you're that little, you don't really remember it anyway. So I think it's good that you're bringing it back and kind of reintroduce us to something like that.
Yeah, so even for me, like growing up, we didn't really do any chant. Of course, like before Vatican II was pretty prevalent in a lot of places. Chant was really heavy in many places, especially like the higher liturgies. And so now we're kind of trying to introduce that a little bit more. I think part of it goes back to the history of chant. So chant is something that is very unique to the church. So like when you go out and just like you hear popular music on the radio and stuff like that, that's unique to our culture, and that's good. I mean, that's great development in music, and music has gone through different stages in history. But chant has really been something that has been unique to the liturgies of the church. So in that way, it's like we keep things kind of special because this is a special place and we're celebrating something very unique and special. Like God is something, like when we come off the streets and we come into the church, it's kind of a sense of like noticing, wow, this is different. This is not ordinary. This is something that we should really pay close attention to and celebrate in a specific way. And so we talk about chant. Again, this has been, you know, since the early days of the church, we've been using this style of music. And so it's really cool, I think, even though I'm not used to it as much, like I play piano. And so it's hard, honestly, if I were to say this, chant is not my preferred style of music, especially from a musician standpoint. When I'm used to playing piano and trying to create music like that's really intricate and stuff like that, and chant is intricate in its own way. But it's not really as much my preference, but it is, part of it is kind of the church's preference. Mm-hmm. I was just reading a document recently that talked about the importance of kind of the fact that chant is kind of, because it's the church's type of music, of kind of having elements of that in our liturgy is something that
I think
important.
That you do it together as a congregation, and something about that, whereas you're very musically inclined and most of us are not, so we can say those chants together. And also the meditative quality of that too, I think.
Sure. And I think chant, especially because it's not popular music, it's not really what we're used to, including myself. I really got more acquainted to it when I was in seminary. But the more it's like classical music, the more that you do it, it's hard at first, but the more that you do it, it becomes a little bit more easy to do. And it also, you kind of start to appreciate the complexity of it, amidst it also being kind of simple at the same time. So the other thing is, you were asking about Latin within that chant. Latin, once again, it's like the language of the church. Again, prior to the 60s, it was always used at Mass for a long time. Not always in history, but many, many years, hundreds and hundreds of years. And so being the language of the church, again, it's just something different. It's something that kind of transcends normalcy. And it also, again, the church's documents kind of say, look, everyone should have a basic understanding of Latin. So again, is that my own personal preference? Not really. It takes work, but that's what the church, it's not about me. It's not even about us. It's about kind of what Jesus gave us, the church. Jesus gave us the church as the way to guide us. And so it's really in Christ, like that's what Christ asked, because he's asking it through the church to enter into these deep traditions of maybe even Latin or some chant. And it, besides that, from a practical standpoint, it just kind of spices things up and kind of mixes things up.
Well,
a
I think
bit.
It's neat too when you think about the history of the church and how many Catholics there are globally. That's like our one common language that our church is based off of.
Yeah,
that I think is neat too.
Yeah, you could go to anywhere, and if they're using Latin, you know, we kind of understand that. So obviously there have been different ebbs and flows to the church, much more Latin before. Now we kind of have more English or the vernacular. And so we're kind of mixing in some of these old traditions of the church to kind of maybe heighten our sense of, wow, there's something special here.
Okay, so what about the incense?
Yeah, so it's kind of similar with the incense as well. So I was talking about recently how incense, again, thousands of years, this is not something obviously that we're inventing. The tradition on the incense is that it kind of, the incense as it rises, and if you really take it in, now this is a funny joke, because sometimes I think, so I could be, you know, five blocks away and have the incense outside and someone would cough, right? Because it's our normal reaction. Oh, there's smoke, I have to cough. And when I was little, I did the same thing. I got to the point eventually I was like, okay, you know, I kind of started to like be like, oh, this actually smells pretty good. But so sometimes it catches us off guard because of that physical nature of smoke. But as we look at it and we kind of see it maybe a little bit more often, we tend to see, like if we look at the symbolism, like the smell, so there's again something unique about that, but then also to see the smoke rising, like prayers are rising to heaven. And so when we offer ourselves at Mass, the incense really is kind of a symbolic way of taking our intentions and our very selves and offering that up before the Father. And so it's a beautiful way, again, to kind of shock us, but also to kind of elevate it and to say there's something special going on here.
And I think at Mass too, you talked about the five senses and about how when you're present at Mass and you have the incense as well, then you're really taking in the Mass with all five of your senses.
Yeah, you're smelling it and you're seeing it rise and all that kind of stuff. And yesterday, actually after Mass, we're here at the Sacred Heart Church in Boone, but the stained glass, which is behind us here, the rose window after Mass, the incense was still in the air, and you could see the refracted light from the stained glass shine on, and it was gorgeous. And so this adds perhaps a sense or a style of beauty, just like for music, for big celebrations, we add complex things just to make things a little special in particular occasions. So.
And we talked a little bit before this too about how one example we read was that having the incense, praying in Latin and adding these little extras is kind of like bringing out your fine china for when you're having dinner guests over or dressing up for a wedding or something like that. Just a different way to celebrate.
Exactly. It just makes it a little bit more special and sets things apart just a little bit. So.
And I think it's important too, because especially with the secularism of our Christian holidays right now, to focus on this season of Advent and not get into so much the Christmas season, which is actually a little later
exactly.
in our tradition.
Yeah, to prepare and to say, yeah, there's something special as we prepare for this. So, yeah, so if, you know, if you're kind of, everyone has different preferences. These are different preferences that people have. Some people like the chant and the incense, some people don't. But these are preferences, and at the heart of our faith is what we teach as a people, it's what we believe. But these little preferences or little traditions can help us to experience these things in different ways. So I would just say, yeah, give it a chance. If you're not quite sure about it, give it a chance and allow these traditions of the church to maybe kind of influence your prayer or something in a positive way. Just kind of see what happens. So,
awesome.
All right.
Thank you.
Cool. Good questions.
Yep.